I have taken life and living from the sea, and have given the same back, I suppose. The complex and all-consuming ocean feeds man, but also feeds upon men. The flat calm that gently digests my troubles is capable of violent turbulence of enough gluttony to chew up and spit out vessels of the strongest steel, often swallowing men and ships whole. The ocean which gives so much takes back what it needs, commanding respect and getting it from those who have seen and understand the hunger. I'm Linda Greenlaw. I am a commercial fisherman, have been for more years than I need to mention, but I was raised on and off the coast of Maine, where this lobster fishery is our way of life. I mean, I spent my early childhood trying to catch anything that swam or crawled along the shores surrounding my home. When I was at an age where kids learned to ride bikes, I learned how to row. When 10-speed bikes were all the rage, I had my very first 10-horsepower outboard motor. My world quickly expanded from the tidal pool to the cove, to the Gulf of Maine, to Georgia's banks, to the Grand Banks of Newfoundland. I have fished the Indian Ocean from Kenya and Somalia to the Maldives. I have fished this planet. I like to know that the resource is going to be here in the state of Maine for the kids that are born here that want to pursue the life that I have had the pleasure of pursuing. I love my life. I want it to be the same for the next generation and generations to come.
But today we're talking about the beginning. So, and this is really where we're at with the Gulf of Maine. And this is illustrative again of the overall process leading up to an auction, proposing an area that we may sell for a company to come in and say, I would like to bid and play in this space. And all that ends up with an auction at the end of that process.
Large sectors of our government continue to work towards a goal of auctioning off our oceans to multinational corporations for the development of floating offshore wind farms. But the people who live in Maine and love it have a passion and resilience that the industrial developers may have underestimated.
Unfortunately, greed is a very big thing in our day and age. A lot of people just get tunnel vision and don't see the consequences. I wish they could just step back a little bit and kind of live it in my shoes for a day. You know what I mean? Like, why don't you come sling 90-pound crates around for a day and see how hard it is to make a dollar what we do? And you might have a better respect and understanding of what we do. Maybe they would kind of consider going somewhere else. And we're not opposed to windmills. We're just opposed of you coming in and taking our space. You can put windmills anywhere, but don't put it where we're fishing. You can't fish around it.
In Maine, fisheries takes up, or really makes up, a greater percentage of the state's economy than almost any other state.
That little Freudian slip from Diamond Offshore Wind CEO Chris Wissman, former Enron Energy Services vice president, is actually quite telling.
In Maine, fisheries takes up, or really makes up, a greater percentage of the state's economy than almost any other state.
Fisheries take up space in Maine's economy, as well as taking up space in the ocean. And to establish a new horizon for revenues for energy conglomerates and their investors, fishermen need to be squeezed out of the ocean to make room for vast arrays of floating turbines offshore. But just try getting a tenacious fishing captain like Linda Greenlaw to go along with that. If the 1991 perfect storm couldn't shake her from the mariner's life she loves, then the white-collar movers and shakers are going to have a challenge on their hands. Carving up the rights to our oceans on paper from the comfort of Wall Street or K Street might be easy for them, but the task of separating a fisherman like Linda from her birthright? That won't be anywhere so easy. I don't care how much clout you supposedly have across finance, governance, science, commerce. Good luck getting the best of anyone who can catch a swordfish. And the same goes for the other commercial fisheries. Confiscating their way of life will be easier said than done.
I've done many different types of fishing, always coming home to Maine to go lobster fishing. And that's what I'm doing presently. I fish out of Perry's Lobster Shack here in Surrey, Maine. But again, I've fished all over the planet. I've seen a lot of changes. I know there's a lot of talk of wind turbines in the Gulf of Maine. I think they'd be devastating to a way of life that we have come to just expect of Maine. It is our tradition. People think of Maine, they think of the Maine lobster. I do charters out of Maine, and people come from all over the world to jump on a boat and see how lobsters are caught. And one of the things that we really impress our clients with is the way we protect our resource. Maine is the only state that has a V-notch law. The state of Maine has done so much to protect the resource. The state of Maine has done a wonderful job branding the Maine lobster, marketing the Maine lobster. We've perfected packaging just to expand that market. So it's disconcerting, to say the least, to know that there's a possible threat to a way of life and the resource itself. These wind turbines will create some jobs. It will never replace lobstering. And the jobs aren't sustainable. Once the turbines are in place, my understanding is they just do their thing. Where are the jobs then? There are so many families whose livelihoods depend on the ocean, catching lobsters. It's putting bait in a trap, throwing it on the bottom, and hoping. That's our way of life. To take that and turn it into something very industrial, I think would be a travesty.
We'll hear more from Linda later on. I arrived early for her interview at the dock she fishes out of, and while I was there, I met Seth Cote, the dock owner who was busy getting set up to sell fresh seafood to passersby on a beautiful June day in Surrey, Maine. I asked him if he'd be willing to let me interview him about his thoughts on offshore wind coming to Maine. I could see his wheels turning as he glanced at my Massachusetts license plate and politely let me know that whoever hired me probably would not be happy about anything that he had to say on the subject. So I explained my motives for starting this project, and he graciously agreed to share his thoughts.
This establishment is Perry's Lobster Shack at 1076 Newbury Neck Road in Surrey. We're right on the water. We're a full wharf for the lobstermen. Linda does some tours off of here. I've got a full restaurant. You eat on the dock itself. So not only are you eating fresh seafood from Maine that is caught right here off of my dock, but you get to see it brought in and stuff like that, which is kind of a cool twist that you don't normally get to see when you're on asphalt and stuff like that. You know, you get this coastal experience, and the true Maine experience is what I like to say. This actually is my fifth year here. My grandparents started it in 1998. They live across the street. My grandfather actually passed away 6 years ago, which is why I ended up buying this. It's just a lot for my grandmother, and losing your significant other after so many years. It's just, sometimes it's time just to step away and bring in some new blood. And I was very fierce to get this up and going. And it's just been a part of my life. This was my first job. I got my worker's permit to come work here when I was 15. It's been a part of me for so long that this is my life at this point. So we're in the top 10 for lobster places to visit in the coast of Maine, which is a huge success, I think, on our part. Seems how you talk to people 5 years ago and they never even heard of Perry's Lobster Shack, right? And now I feel like this is the staple of Surrey. Like, that was my whole thing. Like, when I bought this place, when you thought of Surrey, Maine, you thought of Perry's Lobster Shack. Like, that's what I wanted this experience to literally just blow you out of the water so much that it stuck with you. And it does take a lot of work, but when you have the heart and you have that extra drive to get it done, it's a whole other reward when it comes to that. And to see all these people and the TripAdvisor reviews of, you made our vacation and we've never done anything like this. And it's the little things that go a long ways, and it keeps me doing these hours of constant just making it happen. And now we're on the rebound of COVID, and it's like two summers in one with lack of help. But I feel lucky because people love it here, and I have a full staff, which a couple of weeks ago I didn't, and now I do. So I'm ready to literally take on this year, and we've upped our menu a lot. We've added some salads to our menu. We've got a kids menu. We've added oysters this year, which has been a huge, huge hit. And I'm actually looking on doing an oyster bar live on the dock. So you'll have actual live oysters shucked in front of you to come up and get that. It's been a cool experience for sure. And I'm just excited to see where the next years are gonna bring us.
Reading some of the overwhelmingly positive customer reviews, it's plain to see that Seth and his family have made Perry's something that is well above the average. Especially if we weight it against the now-defunct Ellsworth Denny's as representing the middle-of-the-road average dining quality available to Mainers. Whether you played it safe and ordered a variation on the Grand Slam, or embraced the artery-clogging allure of a country fried steak with mystery gravy, Denny's was always a gamble as far as whether the food would live up to your already low expectations. Yet the place was always open, and seemingly always had at least an hour's wait for your food, no matter how few cars were in the lot. In contrast, the consistency of quality of food and experience at Perry's has established them as a favorite for their loyal repeat guests, and earned reviews on par with eateries that have had a longer time to establish their cult followings, such as Bangor's iconic coffee pot. Perry's Lobster Shack could very well one day be a destination as recognizable and sought after as highly visible classic summer favorites like Route 1 staple Jordan's Snack Bar or the mythical Eagle's Nest over in Brewer.
People can put it two ways. We're either stubborn or we're out to get it. I'm a little bit of both. You know what I mean? I could be super hard-headed, but at the end of the day, I will beat myself in the head until it's done. You know what I mean? It's one of those things where we feel accomplished that from start to finish, this was us. We built this boat. We built this dock. We built it with our own two hands. And it's just a good feeling to know, like, I built that and tons of people enjoy it. That's just cool. A lot of people don't get that opportunity. And that's something that I will never forget either, where I came from, of where this place came from. Like, it always is instilled in the back of my mind that no matter what, how successful this place will be, it'll always be the true Maine experience. And that's something that a lot of people forget. And I feel like Mainers, true Mainers, don't. We're so family oriented. Like, all my family works here. Like, I can call them on a dime and they'll be over here to help me pick lobsters or anything. My brother is a lobsterman off my dock. My sisters work here for years. My mom does all of my accounting stuff, all that jazz. Maine is family. And no matter what, we'll get it done. No matter what, if we gotta work 12 hours out of the 12 hours of the day that we're here, we gotta do it. We have great days and we have days that we're like, we just gotta get it done. I feel like us as Maine, us as the state, DMR, all of us together have done a good job at sustainable fishing. We have figured out a way to make sure that every year we can make sure that lobsters are here, that we're catching lobsters, that we're safe at doing what we're doing. We're making sure that we're not overtaking. We have all the precautions set in stone for a good regulatory fishing that have been years and years of sustainable fishing. And as far as I'm concerned, since I've been a part of the buying industry, because I'm also a wholesale buyer where I have seven lobstermen that sell to me that I buy their lobsters. And over the years, I mean, it's just, I've seen more lobsters and the price has gone up, which in return is good for everybody. There's so much more to the wind turbines that people don't even understand. We've got boat builders that's gonna affect. We've got people with, as far as moorings, all that stuff, people that come here to enjoy boating and stuff like that. And absolutely our lobstermen would be the hardest hit. Just the simple fact of all the area that they would close down is great sustainable fishing for us. We know this works. We don't know what this is gonna be, right? So what I always say is don't fix something that's not broke, right? Windmills are not made for the water. Boats are made for the water, as far as I'm concerned. We need to leave things alone how they are and not keep encroaching on our Maine waters.
Developing clean energy.
The state is fighting the front of the fight against climate change. And
the state's four-year climate action plan, Maine won't wait.
Wean us off of fossil fuels to reach carbon neutrality.
Environmental groups and clean energy groups praising offshore wind power development.
I understand. I totally get it. I get all of that. But at the same time, we have to be smart about it. We can't just be so blind to everything that, okay, this is the way we're going. You know what I mean? We can work with people, but at the same time, they gotta work with us, right? We can't just be take, 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 take. And I feel like it's been like that for many years for lobstermen. There's been a lot of encroachment. It's just been taking, 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 taking until when do we stop? You know what I mean? Like, when does it really end of them taking? What I guess I'm not understanding is I've lobstered offshore before in 40 miles where the wind is crazy. And my question is, how are we gonna keep these upright? What is gonna be in the water to keep these upright? How much land is this really gonna take up? Is there gonna be lines that are gonna be visible? Is it boats gonna be running into things? You know what I mean? There's so many different things that haven't really been talked about that are important as far as I'm concerned. Like, what happens when one of those lays over in the water? You know what I mean? In a big storm, a 70 mile an hour wind comes through and blows all those over, then what happens? So are we really talking pollution then? I mean, because we all know that grease and oil and everything is involved with moving parts, which all windmills have grease and oil and everything else. So if those laid over, then what would we have for equipment to pick them back up? You know what I mean? If a boat goes down, boom, we've got 10 people that are gonna go zip out real quick, grab that thing and bring it in. What is gonna happen with something like that? You know what I mean? There's just so many other factors that we don't know what's gonna happen. Like I said, we do know with lobstering. And there's a lot of confusion on what really happens out there, and a lot of people don't do it. And when you talk about the whales, like, people don't know that there's the tide. So when a whale gets struck by a big ship and it's killed, all that happens is it gets into the tide. When it gets into the tide, they spin because they have fins. So once they're in the water, they spin and they get tangled up in rope. It's just, that's how it is. The other thing, when you're talking about pollutions with boats and stuff like that, we pride ourselves on our boats. My friend Linda, she's got a beautiful 58 and a half foot boat that she prides her life on, I guarantee it. We're not gonna wanna be out there like, oh, so-and-so's got a trash boat that's leaking fuel, you know what I mean? That's not what we're like. We pride ourselves on our boats, just like any other company prides themselves on their uniforms, their building, their, you know what I mean? That this is our business on the water. And I just feel like this is the final straw, you know what I mean? Like, you talk to a lot of fishermen and they're upset, like, which they should be. Like, they grew up doing this, and this is like a lot of what we know, and I don't want to see the same thing happen that mills in Maine happened, like Bucksport Mill, all that stuff getting shut down. A lot of my family was at the Bucksport Mill, and you know, that's all they knew for 30 years. And what are you supposed to do after 30 years of doing the same thing? You do the same thing, right? And that's what Mainers do. And it's hard for people to understand exactly where you're coming from until you're born and raised in Maine. When I saw that happen at Bucksport Mill, there was a face of panic in a lot of people. And we're so used to doing the same thing that it's a culture shock. I mean, it's just like taking a fish out of water. I mean, it just uproots so much, and people don't understand that the toll it does take on families. You know, like, especially with COVID last year, this is completely different, but I was so scared. I didn't know what was gonna happen. My whole life is invested in this place, and I just didn't know what was gonna happen. So I could only imagine what that would be like if someone just said, you're done.
A lot has been happening in Seth's world since I met him last June. He now has a son, Dawson, who looks like he's inherited more than a little of the determination that runs in the family. Adding fatherhood to his responsibilities as a business owner only serves to further bolster Seth's resolve to preserve his home community.
As you know, the coast is pretty much made of fishermen and tourists. And if we don't have fishermen with lobsters, providing lobsters to our restaurants and people like me, there's no reason for me to be here, right? You know what I mean? What am I gonna do if my fishermen can't fish and I can't buy lobsters? So if I don't have lobsters, then I don't have tourists. Maine would be gone. It's one of those things, it's just, I think we really need to step back and really look at what windmills could do, because I feel like there's not as many benefits as cons. I don't want this to happen to all of the fishermen, all of the people that are buying lobsters, all the boat builders. I mean, I could go on for days on what the trickle-down effect that lobstering affects on people. It would ruffle a lot of feathers, for sure. And you can talk to many lobstermen. I mean, there's some, obviously, that can adapt and do whatever to make ends meet, but we don't want to. Right? Because this is the job that we chose, and you know, this is what we want to continue to do. Our families have done it for generations and generations, and I look back to, so like, my grandfather's gone now, but I have so many memories of here. We have to work in Maine, and we work as a family. So we work together. Sometimes we all can't get together and have dinner at the end of the night because we're working. And so we'll work together as a family. We're not here to cause trouble and everything else. We just want to stick doing what we've done for generations and continue our Maine tradition.
Everyone's in favor of protecting the environment, but I think people don't have enough information about the reality of these turbines. They're not little windmills. They're giant pieces of machinery. They are industrial. Just think about the mooring systems for these giant pieces of machinery. Big chain, sweeping and grinding, productive lobster bottom. I mean, that's habitat for a lot of living creatures. And to disturb that and upset the balance, you really need to think long term. I've heard different numbers about the longevity of these turbines themselves. Are they good for 10 years? Well, that's a pretty harsh environment, believe me. I've spent most of my life bobbing around the North Atlantic Ocean. There's not a piece of machinery made that can sort of live up to anyone's expectations in that brutal and harsh environment. When it comes time to replace them, maintaining them, it's ships. It's ships that burn fossil fuel. You know, so it's not this super green, environmentally friendly energy that it's been sold as. And I hope people will really do their homework, really do their research, and learn a lot more about these turbines before they're okay putting them in the middle of the Gulf of Maine. Everyone wants to do the right thing for the environment, of course, but to sacrifice something like a lobster fishing industry or just fishing in general? How about ecotourism? I mean, that's a huge growing industry in the state of Maine. People come to Maine, for the most part, to be on or around the water. They want to see the lobster boats coming and going. They want to eat lobster. You know, I really see the long term, if this wind turbine thing takes off, I see that crushing what Maine is essentially about. The selling points, green energy, environmentally friendly. Everyone loves that. Who's gonna fight that? But to know the rest of the story, you know, the problem is that people who see issues as black and white are missing the meat of the issue, which is gray. It's somewhere in between. Yes, wind, it's free. These turbines are not free, and they, at the end of the day, are not environmentally friendly. It's really upsetting to think that just something we've been doing for so long, and we've done it right. We've protected the environment. We have protected the resource. Fishermen today, believe me, I've been doing this for a long time. The younger generations are great stewards of the resource and of the ocean. They understand the importance of it more than I did as a kid. You know, things have changed. We understand these things now. Let's not go backwards. I believe that wind turbines in the Gulf of Maine would be a regression in stewardship of our ocean.
Linda and Seth were not sponsored to appear in this series. Both volunteered time out of their busy days to tell me what they think, because this is an issue that they care about. Local perspectives like theirs don't get much play in a media environment largely focused on recycling most of the same stories about climate change, endangered whales, and clean energy. But you get a much clearer picture of all the issues when you talk to people like Linda and Seth, who are actually invested in their communities. Maine's coast is their home, and they want to protect it. Linda is an accomplished author, and one way you can support her is by picking up some of her books, which can be found at lindagreenlawbooks.com. You'll find nonfiction about her fascinating life, original detective mysteries set in coastal Maine, even cookbooks. She has been prolific. And if reading any of these books makes you wish you could just be on a boat with Linda, you can achieve your dream by booking a custom charter with Linda herself. The website to make that happen is lindagreenlawcharters.com. And before or after your charter, you can treat yourself to a lobster roll, a crab roll, or one of the other fine offerings that Seth's crew will be serving up for you at Perry's Lobster Shack, which is the very dock that Linda runs her charters out of. Editing this footage has really made my mouth water because I actually didn't get to try anything off of the Perry's menu. I was there shooting video well before they were open for lunch, and then I had to run right over to Sedgwick to catch Brian Tripp for an interview and still make an afternoon ferry boat to Swan's Island. So it was just a tightly scheduled day, and I wished I had a little leisure time to grab a bite. But I'm definitely planning on swinging in for some fresh Maine-caught seafood the next time I'm anywhere near Surrey. So that's all I've got for this episode. And I've got to get back to my day job for a few weeks and pay the bills. But look for the next video to be coming sometime in April. And thank you all for watching.